What is up, guys? I do hope you're well. My name is Mark, and today we're checking out some more r/ entitled parents. If you're new here, please consider hitting that like, that subscribe, and maybe that notification bell. And with that being said, let's get straight into today's stories. Much love, guys. Our first story comes from Nanny Lynn, 62. I am the queen of passive aggression. My hobby used to be making quilts from vintage cloth. I would buy the cloth, usually flower and feed print sacks from the 30s and 40s at flea markets and antique stores. I pieced them by hand and sewed the squares together on my old treadle sewing machine. Then I would hand quilt the tops using vintage blankets as batting and older cotton thread. This took a lot of time and the end results were beautiful and heirloom quality. Besides, it was a lot of fun. One year I made a such quilt for my brother-in-law's birthday, husband's younger brother. He and his wife freaked out over it and thanked me profusely. 2 days later, my mother-in-law walked into my house without even knocking. Her reasoning was that it was her son's house and therefore her right to do so. I'd been super busy all day and just sat down on the living room floor to play Super Mario Kart with my boys. I was surprised to see her. She usually avoided me if my husband wasn't around. She snorted at me when she saw me on the floor and asked me if this is what I did all day, and then added it must be nice to have so much free time. I've always worked from home. You'd be surprised at how many people think this isn't a real job. Then she dumped a bunch of fabric swatches out of her bag onto my sofa. Before I could ask her what she was doing, she started telling me that she wanted a quilt like the one I made for my brother-in-law, but she needed hers to be bigger and with these colours. Oh, and she wanted a new cloth, not that old junk. She just brought these swatches so I'd know what to buy for her quilt. At first I was too stunned to speak up, then I was too angry to trust my mouth. My two boys never liked this woman and they scrambled to their feet and ran out of the room. I envied them for this because I was stuck facing this cow alone. This woman had always been awful to me as she could. She had told my boys to their little faces that they were not her grandsons because they looked nothing like her son. She told her other grandkids this too, so we weren't singled out. She told all of her five sons that she would only recognise her daughter's kids because she knew those were her grandkids. She only claimed the other grandkids were hers when she wanted to look good around other people. This woman had tried to fix my husband up with other women for 5 years after we were married. This woman, who'd been trying to make me freak out for the past 18 years, was so entitled that she thought I would do this work for her for free. So I looked through the swatches, asked for the dimensions she wanted, as well as the block pattern. Thought for a few moments and told her, yeah, I can do that, for about $5,000. I figured that this was a large enough sum to freak her out and make her go away. If not, well sure, I'll make her a quilt for that stupid amount. She said, $5,000? But you just gave one to brother-in-law. That was a birthday present. Well then, this can be my birthday present. I've never given you a birthday present. The only time I tried to, you handed it back unopened. You told me that you only accepted gifts from family or friends, and that I was neither. $5,000 up front or no quilt. Frowning and pressing her lips together, she gathered up her stupid swatches and left. I opened the door for her and held it so she couldn't slam it. She was a slammer. As I watched her drive away, I couldn't help but think of how much fun that had been. So for the rest of the year, my husband's other three brothers got quilts for their birthdays. Also, to add insult to injury, I made them out of new cloth and not that old junk, as well as the colours and patterns my mother-in-law wanted, because I knew it would get back to her that I had done this. This crazy woman tried as hard as she could to guilt one of her sons into giving her their quilt. Nope, didn't happen. 1993 was a fun year. Our next story is from Glader122. Your kid falls out of the cart and it's my fault. I used to work at Walmart, it was okay. One day I woke up, put on my wage slave smile and went in to earn those crumbs. I was meant to be in jewellery, and since Walmart is famous for its jewellery, I was obviously helping clean up elsewhere while my department was dead as fuck. I was wiping down some shelves when a mum walked by with a crying kid in her cart. I ignored it at first because kids cry all the time. But this wasn't really a gimme candy cry, it was more of a robust, ouch, this actually hurts cry. So I went to check on it. Turns out that the kid, maybe 4 to 5, had fallen out of the cart a few minutes ago, busted his lip and was bleeding a bit. Ouch, sucks. Don't stand in a moving cart next time and maybe watch your kid better. Lessons learned all around. I gave mum the roll of paper towels I had been cleaning to wipe his tears and nose and stuff, then went to call a manager. On the way to the phone and radio, I passed by a pharmacy. It wasn't out of the way, otherwise I wouldn't have stopped, and asked them to take the kid an ice pack if they had one. I radio the manager over and meet her back at the kid. Mum and newly arrived grandma maybe 5 minutes later. This kid wasn't crying anymore, had his ice pack and looked okay if not a little swollen around the lips. Kids are durable, he'll fall out of another cart another day. Mum looked a little upset, but the grandma looked like I pushed the kid out of the cart and then roughed him up a little too, while I was at it. She was pissed. She said I wasn't concerned enough and that I didn't spend enough time checking on the kid. Cause you know how all Walmart employees are nurses. Also, how did the kid fall out the cart in the first place? Why didn't I do more? How callous of me. So I'm like, I didn't even see him fall, just heard crying. I gave the mum what I could and immediately went for management and first aid. My manager heard this and said thanks, so I let her deal with it. Later I get called into the office. Turns out the grandma wanted to report to corporate and wanted my job. Shocker, I know. So I gave her my side of the story. I followed procedure properly, so all good there. Unsurprisingly, nothing came of it, and I don't think the grandma ever called corporate. Not a week later, I did catch a kid mid-topple as they were standing in their cart, reaching for something while their mum had her back turned. Watch your kids, people. Our next story is from Random3177. EK sexually assaults my daughter, finds out the hard way she's been taught to take care of herself. So this is my second story. Little background, I'm an Iraqi war vet, and I believe teaching the women and girls in my life to defend themselves with impunity. So at the very young age of 4, I've been teaching my child to defend herself. Story time. I'm at work one day and I get this call from my daughter's school. I go outside to answer the phone and the conversation goes like this. Cast, me, Terminator, P, principal. Hello Terminator, I need you to come pick up baby Terminator. I say, can I ask you what this is about? He said, yes, your child has been in a fight and needs to leave the school premises. I said, what do you mean she's been in a fight? What happened? I mean, she wouldn't just pick a fight. Well, from what we can tell, EK was running up behind her and grabbing her butt. She apparently warned him to stop, and when he wouldn't, she knocked him out cold. To which I say, so I'm confused what was happening to the boy then. He said, well, your daughter seems to be the aggressor, and we need her to leave, and she is going to be suspended. Now, my child at the time lived with my ex-wife, and I heard from the ex that my kid was having an issue with this boy for a while now, and I knew my daughter had gone through many times telling on him to no resolve. I also knew that he had been told many times by teachers to stop it, and he hadn't. I said, wait, so nothing has been done about the boy sexually assaulting my daughter for X amount of time? Well, Mr. Terminator, she did strike him once and knocked him out. She needs to learn violence is not the answer. She needed to bring it up to the attention of a teacher. Okay, so what I'm hearing is your school is saying it's okay to sexually assault a girl, and that the girl in question needs to be a victim of assault over and over again, or be punished. Is that about the gist of it? Now I hear silence as the principal just mulls over what I just said. I can tell they're trying to justify this weak tea bullshit. I compose myself. So here's what's going to happen next. You can either punish both or punish none of them, because I promise you the last thing you want is me and my dress A's and TV reporters showing up and blasting your whole school over this. Now I can understand that her punching this brat is unacceptable, but what I will not take, and neither will she, is him not being punished as well. Do I make myself clear? He's silent. Also, why are you calling me and not her mother? The principal said, well, Mr. Terminator, she told us to call you. You listen to me and listen good. I swear to you and God I will not put up with this. I demand a meeting with you, her teacher and this boy's family. If I can't make it, my ex-wife will. If this isn't resolved to my liking, I will bring holy hell upon this whole stick house you built. Do you understand me? The principal says, yes, sir. Good. Call my ex and let her know the time and date. We will coordinate from there. I hang up and call my ex. She agrees with me and I go back to work. About a work week later, there is a meeting, but unfortunately, I have work and my ex has to go in for me. From what I am told, this boy's family tries to play it off as boys will be boys and tries to get my daughter expelled. There are times when I remember why I married my ex and this is one of them. She proceeds to tell them that the last thing any of them want is me to get involved more than I already have, and that if I have to, I will bring it all burning down, every brick. Outcome was both were suspended for 4 days and that the boy was moved to a different class, and I never got a call like that again. Moral of the story, my kid's a badass and got cake for sticking up for herself, and a lot of love on both ends of me and my ex. Edit, sorry for not being clear, she was 7.5 at the time of this incident. The next story is from WhatTheHell431. I witnessed an EM getting destroyed. I saw this today and I can't stop laughing. I was travelling my city metro. It wasn't that much crowded at the time, but all the seats were occupied. Still, you could freely stand without being humped by a stranger. There was this kid sitting in the reverse seat, the ones for people with handicaps, pregnant women and old people, definitely not for mums of 2-year-olds. He's probably 14 or 15, I don't know. He's the hero of the story here. Then at one stop, our EM comes in. She has this cute little child who's trying to keep up with his mum's pace. EM instantly sees our hero sitting in the reserve seat and just stares at him. I guess this was her way to make people automatically give away their seats or something. The kid didn't move though. This probably irked EM a lot, I guess, because she moved towards the kid with heavy steps. She comes near him, stops, and again does the stare. The kid doesn't budge. Then she starts screaming. If she didn't have the whole compartment's attention earlier, she had it now. She starts berating the kid for sitting in a reverse seat and not giving it to someone more deserving, like a mother like herself with a young kid. I don't know what her logic was, the seats aren't reserved for them anyways. She just keeps shouting and screaming and tries to get others' opinions on it, and for a while people were on her side. Then the kid, out of nowhere, rolls the right side of his jean up and detaches the artificial leg and keeps it in front of EM. The look on her face was priceless, it looked like she was mortified and embarrassed at the same time. She just backed away silently and just got off at the next stop. I don't think that was her stop. Breastfeeding isn't allowed if you're a teen mum. Mobile. So back in high school, one of my closest friends got pregnant and gave birth to the sweetest baby boy. She stopped going to school for a while to take care of her kid, but still online school so she could graduate with her class. One thing we would do is go to the local food places near the high school on Fridays, and today we decided to go to this nice Chinese place that I frequent regularly. And the little old Asian lady knows me by name. This Chinese place has a sticker on the front door that says something like, breastfeeding will always be allowed, which is great since that's what my friend is more comfortable doing for her baby. After we order our food and hang out in this little waiting area, when the baby gets all fussy, she takes out the little cover and covers the baby. She takes out the little cover and covers her baby and her chest as she starts to feed him. We keep talking to this woman and her son, who had to be around 10, comes in. I recognise this kid as one of the kids I look after when I used to volunteer at a youth centre. He comes up to me and starts talking to me, then asks my friend what she's doing with the baby. Before my friend could answer, the boy's mother cuts in. A disgusting thing is what she is doing. Don't you know better than to do that in public? And why are you even doing that if you're only a kid? My friend has an attitude sometimes, so I try to jump in before she starts to throw things. It's not illegal, and Mrs. L is fine with it. She has a sticker on the door. Mrs. L being the little old Asian lady by the counter, who was just oogling the baby a second ago, she smiles at us and continues to write some stuff down. The mother wasn't happy about this and continues with her BS. I'm sorry, but I'm not okay with a baby breastfeeding another baby. Can you please just stop? She says in frustration. Mrs. L finally cuts in, and in her broken English says, nursing baby is a beautiful thing. You have a problem, you leave. She then taps the order on the window that leads to the kitchen and apologises to my friend for the woman's nasty behaviour. She then looks at the boy who is still next to me and says jokingly, your mother, she dummy, right? This makes the boy laugh and the mother just grumbled in her seat, trying to stay as far from us as she could. When my friend is finished and we grabbed our food, Mrs. L threw in an extra order of egg rolls since they were my friend's favourite. Everything was fine until Monday came and I saw the boy again. He pulls me off to the side and tells me that his mum said she doesn't like me or my friend. I just ask him if he still likes me and he says yes. Yay! Our next story is from Iron Potato Man. How I started a revolution in my entitled family. All I wanted was my sisters. I posted part of this in r/AmITheArsehole as a recent conflict I will bring up later left me doubting myself, but due to so many people's interest, I've decided to elaborate my family's boundless entitlement here. I'm currently in custody of my two little sisters, Amy who is 17 and Lisa who is 8, not their real names for obvious reasons. I'm a 29 male and we live in Australia. I am Potato, as that's what Lisa calls me. And this is basically the story of how my family felt they're entitled to both my sisters' bodies, and I wouldn't stand for that. I'd like to warn anyone who's faced abuse in the past, as parts of their story may trigger some people. And to anyone who's faced abuse in the past, I do feel deeply sorry for you. The main part of the story takes place about a year ago. I'd moved out 6 years ago at the time and moved to another state for work and study. I was honestly really slack with keeping contact with my family, which is probably why this went on so long. When I do think back to the time before I moved out, I didn't treat Amy the best, and if I hadn't moved out and had so little contact with my family, I may have turned out just as entitled and as much of a horrible person. I came back to visit for a grandparent's birthday. After spending so long away, I spent the morning catching up with aunts, uncles, cousins, my parents, and of course Lisa. Now, this was actually the first time I'd realised the oddities of my family. Perhaps it was just the change in environment. A few of my roommates had little sisters and whatnot after all. But it was the first time I'd noticed how quiet the little girls in my family were. I guess I'd always thought of Amy as just shy and quiet, but my little cousins were so much the same. Polite, shy, quiet, and obedient. Though at the time, I just brushed this off. After a few hours, I realised that Amy was nowhere to be seen all day. The party was at my parents' house, so this confused me. And I slipped inside to see if she was cooped up in her room, like a lot of 16-year-olds would be, talking to friends or doing assessments. What I found is a memory that will haunt me forever. My oldest uncle on my father's side, laying over my sister, who was clearly quite in a lot of pain and struggling not to cry as he pinned her beneath him. I completely lost it as any brother would, shouting at him to get off her and out of her room. I scared the hell out of both of them, but in that moment, I was honestly ready to kill my uncle. Amy was pretty messed up in the head when I tried consoling her. She was covered in scars, had a rash that I later found out was an allergic reaction. She was allergic to strawberries. She didn't speak and looked at me as if she expected for me to hurt her too. Her room was dimly lit, the blinds taped close to her wall. All things she had had when I left were gone, leaving her bedroom feeling cold and empty. And to add insult to injury, she was a month pregnant. When I demanded an explanation from my parents, they, paraphrasing, said it was my uncle's right, and my father simply pointed out one of my 11-year-old cousins sitting quietly with her parents and told me to have fun. I stormed off back to Amy's room, quietly packed her bag of necessities and managed to sneak her out of the house and into my car before doing the same with Lisa. Part of me wanted to get all my cousins out too, but my main focus was Amy right now, who sat trembling in the back of my car. I drove them both to the closest police station to report what was happening. I skipped most of the details of the legal battle that ensued, but my family did not take kindly to being outed for what they were doing. It was a tradition that spanned generations, and that there shouldn't be anything wrong with tradition. Amy and Lisa were put into temporary foster care. Amy was a wreck. To her, everyone could and would hurt her, and I got reports every few hours that she was having a panic attack. Three of my uncles went to jail for a very long time. I got a fair bit of money out of a range of family members, full custody of both Amy and Lisa, no enforced visitation to their parents. My parents had to pay for any therapy costs, medication, and medical needs for both of them. My family was torn in two by this, many of my aunts leaving their husbands with their children after finally having the courage to follow me. Uncles had married into the family, took their wives, who had also been abused, and cut off ties. I still keep in contact with these members of the family, and I'm grateful for their support, and glad that my cousins are safer now. Even some of the older guys who had been brought up thinking it was okay to treat women that way took themselves into counselling once they realised how messed up it was. And I've had more than one instance where they admitted to hurting Amy and apologised, which I've accepted as these cousins did their best to take their siblings or other cousins out of harmful environments. Now, I do believe some part of the ruling protected the younger men of the family, provided they see some form of mental health professional, as they grew up thinking this was normal, so they didn't end up in jail but did end up on the list of possible sex offenders. Not entirely sure there. No one is sure who fathered Amy's child, but she had her pregnancy terminated, as we are told her physical and mental health would not cope with carrying a baby she ultimately unlikely care for. She did consent at the time, and it was brought up by her psychologist once she was doing better, and she confirmed that she would have no love for the baby due to the circumstances which she fell pregnant. For 6 years, Amy had been physically, sexually, mentally and emotionally abused, in every way conceivable. This mostly came from my father's four brothers and brother-in-law who married into the family. My parents both stood by and let this happen, offering no support for Amy. During the case, my uncles argued it was their birthright being born into their family, and it was simply Amy's rite of passage before she was married off to one of my uncle's mates at 18. They used her allergy as a form of torture and manipulation. Wanting her to be silent and obedient, they pressed strawberries against her skin anytime she said a word and forced her to eat them when she stepped too far out of line. A lot of my aunts from my father's side admitted to enduring this treatment too, although most of them were lucky and didn't have allergies to exploit. I honestly can't even begin to explain everything that was wrong with Amy because of their behaviour. Lisa, for the most part, was okay. She needed a little therapy as they were being groomed into compliance and taught that what she would experience was normal. But Amy had completely shut down. It took 2 months before I could even get her speaking. She trusts me now, and we often sit down and I let her talk and open up about whatever she feels comfortable to. Her stories often have me struggling to hold back tears when I comfort her. I did get Amy a service dog a few months ago, tailored towards the emotional support she needs on a regular basis. Lickety Split is honestly the goodest of good doggos. She knows exactly when she's needed and is a massive help when it comes to calming Amy's anxiety, especially in public. We've had more than one encounter with unrelated entitled parents thinking they or their kid deserves her dog more than her. Let me know if you want these stories published too, because I've seen people like to read about service dog related incidents. But anyone who does think that can honestly fight me. No one deserves a dog more than her. On one occasion, one of my aunts, her husband went to jail, tried taking Lickety Split because their money paid for her. I told her if she ever comes near my property again, I would call the police as there was a restraining order against her towards both my sisters. Later she came back, tried to poison Lickety Split with tainted meat, but one of my lovely neighbours caught her and chased her off. Police were called, she's now in jail too, after having to pay a fine and some money to me because at this point I'm pretty well acquainted in the legal system and sued her. My family still tried to get my sisters out of my care, reporting me for everything from animal abuse to drug trafficking. They planted drugs in an identical stuffed toy to Amy's comfort toy and left it in the yard. But Amy would never do that, so I knew something was up immediately. Home security system worked wonders. I've actually become pretty chummy with the local police officers who have to inspect their claims, but they know I'd never do anything to endanger my custody over the girls. They mean the world to me. I will admit it though, I have done things to hurt me bond with them, yelling when stressed and throwing things from time to time, but I'm not perfect and Amy has told me that although these moments do scare her, she doesn't feel endangered being near me when they happen. I also spoil them a little when they do happen. Now the reason this ended on a am I the arsehole is because a few weeks ago my mother contacted me saying she wanted to talk. I was hesitant, but I agreed and we met up in the next town over. No way I could be followed home. My mother explained how she was in the process of divorcing my father and she wanted to have a relationship with me and my sisters, with emphasis on mending her bond with Amy, who had not called her mum in years. She explained how she was pressured into marriage after she had gotten pregnant with me and never wanted that life for her daughters. I flat out told her no, something several members of my family disagreed with, as she could have done literally anything to support Amy emotionally with what was happening. Done anything to make her feel better or more secure with what was happening to her, but instead she was shunned and isolated except for when she needed to cook, clean or provide some sort of service to the family, even going as far as to berate her when she did try to confide in my mum that she was in pain or scared. Amy was well past her breaking point when I took her and even on planning on killing herself less than a week after my visit. My mother argued that she had the same right as the other members of my family who left and had contact with my sisters, but I told her because they were doing it to protect their children and themselves. They didn't wait a year after losing custody to try and fight for them, and I really don't even need to give a reason. I have custody and she does not. Members of Am I the Arsehole convinced me that when Amy is in a better place mentally and Lisa is older, I bring it up with them, leave the decision in their hands. I've been told Amy will be a dependent well after she turns 18. Her mind just doesn't function properly, so there's no risk of her mother getting in contact behind my back, even when she's an adult. And Amy does have a phone and a computer. She doesn't have any social media, and she doesn't want any chance of her family trying to contact her as they threatened her with many forms of torture in the past. This story doesn't have a slam dunk ending. I have my sisters and they're in a safe environment where they get to grow up as kids. Amy is getting the help she needs and is slowly making her way out of the tower she built to protect herself in the only way she could. But she knows there isn't a rush to come out. I'll work at her at the pace she set. She's still discovering her own interests, but quite likes just reading a book with a form of fruity tea. She also has a small collection of stuffed animals, mostly Build-A-Bear, that she adores and takes one with her everywhere. She's sensitive to texture, so the feeling is a comfort for her. And once a week we sit down to try and find older bears she likes. We only have 3 Build-A-Bears on her wish list, and honestly, I've loved helping Amy discover herself. She lost a lot of ability to think and feel for herself during this time, and watching her find her favourite book genre or her favourite types of music is a great feeling. Knowing how far she's come, and I live for the days, she actually manages a smile. I'd be willing to answer most questions if you want to know anything. Just ask, as I want to bring awareness to these things that are still happening to other kids, but obviously, some things I'd rather keep to myself for the girl's sake. Edit. First off, thanks for the awards, it means a lot, and thank you to everyone for offering your kind words and support. It's honestly really difficult this past year, and at times I do struggle, but I have to stay strong for my 2 little girls. They depend on me so much. The support everyone has shown is truly the best. Some extra notes. Amy was pulled out of school at 10, a few months after I left home. She was kept isolated in her room and had very little meaningful contact. Also, I'm not going to share a photo of Lickety Split, as she is a very recognisable dog, and not everyone who has contact with Amy and her dog know the full story, so I'd rather not draw links between this story and her real day-to-day life, as she struggles with it enough. Edit 2. Wow, this blew up overnight. Thank you for all the awards, and sorry if I don't get back to some people. Also, I'm meeting back up with my mother later today to talk to her about the possibility of seeing the girls in the future, once Amy is a lot more stable and Lisa is old enough to understand what I saved her from, and the decision will be entirely theirs. Edit 3. Answering the commonly asked questions to save myself repeating. Yes, I was groomed too, but much differently. I was taught I could treat the women in my family how I wanted, but I was never really a violent person and sexually driven. I was a jerk, and although I have anger issues at the time, taking it out on other people is not something I ever saw effective. My focuses were more on my studying. Some of the other men in my family were the same and were never really abusive. Unfortunately, it never really clicked in my head that if I was being taught that, what were they teaching my sisters behind my back? I blame myself because of how long Amy suffered and do my best to make amends for it by showing her love no one else cared to do. I'm in therapy too. I work closely with Amy's therapist too, so don't worry about my mental well-being. I'm looking after me too. And for those mentioning BS because I didn't go into detail about all the legal detail, I'd go days on just a few hours sleep during the whole legal battle because I'd be looking to every detail I could to know how to help my sisters. Most of it is a messy blur. I also didn't feel many people would care to listen and I had to chop loads out of my story and still had people saying it was too long. The story is unbelievable. I get that. I wouldn't want to believe it either. You don't need to say it though. Just downvote and move along. I don't care what you choose to believe. Amy was pulled out under the premise that she was being homeschooled. I'm not sure how it worked from there. I was never homeschooled and I didn't homeschool the girls. I'm not sure how my family got around docs or anything like that. I just know it worked for 6 years. Wow. You know, when you get these stories on Entitled Parents, it sort of hits you straight in the side. You know, usually their Entitled Parent stories come across as quite a laugh and because you get Karens throwing a wobbly and stuff like that. But when you get these abusive stories, someone going through sexual, physical torture, abuse, man, it sort of hits home. It brings tears to my eyes thinking that someone, and no doubt still right now, someone is going through something like this. It drives me mad. I'm not even going to ask what your favorite story is on this one, because not that this one's going to be your favorite story, but I'm damn sure this is going to be the one that stands out, because that story is just so crazy. The guy himself says it's unbelievable. Do you know what? I believe it, and I'm just so sorry someone's had to go through that, that Amy is in a bad place. Obviously, she's in a much better place now with her brother by her side. Thank God. And it may sound cheesy, if this guy ever does get to see this reading, please let me know and let's get one of those Builder Bears to your sister. I would be honoured to do that. Both your sisters, of course. And I'm just so glad he's looking after himself at the same time. What an absolute crazy family that is. So what do you guys make of this story? I'd love to know in the comments below. Obviously, it's a bit of a hard one. Yeah, it took me a while to read this one because some of the details in there are just horrible, you know. But yeah, I'd love to know your comments below. And as always, I'd just like to say thank you for being here, guys. It's really appreciated you taking time out of the day to this channel. If you do have a moment, if you'd like to click that like, share, subscribe, whatever, it's always truly appreciated. And also, I'd just like to mention something. I had a message yesterday that sort of cut me up a little bit. I had someone say that I'm just doing this purely, for the money. Let me assure you right now, this channel makes barely any money. I'm telling you that right now. I get demonetized on the daily. My favorite thing with this channel, and let me stress this, is like daily, every day, someone tells me the shit that happens in their lives. And you know what? I consider myself incredibly gifted to be able to help someone. I'm no therapist or anything, don't get me wrong, but to listen to someone, and if that helps them out, I love it. I consider myself gifted to be able to help someone. I see our community on Discord from all walks of life going through a huge range of life issues. And I'm grateful for each and every one of you for being involved. Thank you so, so much. I know that sounded cheesy. Thank you so, so much. Much love, guys. And take care of yourselves. Goodbye.